Good morning, Westside. How's everyone doing this beautiful Sunday fall morning? Everybody doing good? If you would stand, we will start with our first hymn today. It is actually on page 54. It is a little bit of a new one. I'll sing the first part. We'll go through it twice. Just join in with me. It is, I say Agnes Day, but it's probably wrong. I probably butcher it with my Kentucky accent. But let us lift up a joyful noise to the Lord this morning with our first hymn. Let's lift it up now.
This morning, and give answer to us, for we are poor and needy, and you are great and mighty. You truly are holy. Preserve our lives, O Lord. Save your servants as we trust in you. You are our God. Be gracious to us, Lord. To you we cry all the day. We need your help, O God. We need your refreshment in our souls. We need your strength in our weaknesses, O Lord. And we are mindful this morning of many who are struggling, many who are sick that are on our minds and our hearts, and we lift them up to you now. We still continue to pray for those affected by the hurricane, Lord. and even those here in our state affected by floods many weeks ago, rebuilding a new season in life, O God. We ask for your grace upon their lives. Give ear to all of our prayers. We need your grace. And in this day of trouble, we call upon you because we believe that you answer your people. There is none like you among all the other gods that are made and created, O Lord. There are none that do the works that you do. Turn to us today, Lord, in this service, and be gracious to us. Give your strength to your people, and bring salvation unto us. May your favor and your face rest upon us today. And we ask these things in the precious and holy name of our Savior, Redeemer, Shepherd, and Friend, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, I do welcome you all today as we prepare here in just a moment to continue singing unto the Lord. And you sounded so beautiful. It was so sweet to hear you singing those words, holy, holy. And so God bless you as you have come, as we are here. May God bless our time together. I'm so thankful to see each and every one of you. I will say that maybe if this is your first time here, we do welcome you. We're blessed that you're here. Or maybe you've been here and you've never connected with us. There's a couple of ways that you can do that. One is in your bulletin. There's a little tear-out section. You can just fill out a little bit of information there, whatever you wish for us to have. And you can drop that in the offering plate as it passes by in just a little bit. Or you can just simply text the word welcome to 859-986-3444 either way. And if we can be of any help to you in your spiritual journey with Christ, we would love to do that. May the Lord bless us as we continue to worship.
That we've forgotten, but that we remember and are cold, and pay too little mind to the voice of God. Still we dare to be so bold.
Our prayer, O Lord, and heal our prayer.
Amen, amen. Aren't you getting a blessing already in church today? If you would, we will. If you would stand, please. We'll continue on with our worship today. And 491, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Let's lift it up on that first verse.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Let us free by the truth you now bring us.
Offertory hymn for the day, coming to that fount of every blessing, coming to the throne room of God. It says in John 1:16, we have all received grace after grace from his fullness. What a great promise. Our offertory hymn today will be, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. We'll sing all three verses.
Come thou fount of every blessing.
Jason will come forward. Got an announcement.
I've called Brother Allen up because I'd like to have a brief prayer for the UK football team. No, I'm just kidding. Now, this is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we've called Allen up, and I see Paula's busy over there. Paula, you could come on up.
Come on up here, buddy.
Come on down.
She's just as important. But we have a small token of our appreciation we'd like to give to Paula.
Okay. Thank you.
I just want everybody to know, I believe we're honored to have such a fine man as our pastor.
Amen.
And just as honored to have Paula as his wife. A great year. I'm honored to also call him my friend.
Amen. He's, I feel the same way.
He's a good man. It's a tough calling being a pastor. I've not got that calling, but I've seen the strain on my friends, not just Brother Allen, but my other friends that are pastors, and it is difficult. Continue to keep Brother Allen and all pastors in your prayers.
You.
There's a lot of a lot of good, a lot of great things to see. We see Lord lead others to know Him.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen lost souls saved.
Mm-hmm.
But there's the hard parts too, and see a lot of struggle out there in the community and in our church. And so continue to pray for Brother Allen. And but we do thank you for being
thank
here.
You.
We thank you for continuing to lead, to boldly preach God's word.
Mm-hmm.
And not to waver, and we thank you so much.
Thank
for all
you all.
You do for us.
We love you all and appreciate you so much. Thanks, Jay.
Well, they're coming forward again. We'll be passing out the plates and everything for today's offering, but if you feel more comfortable, there are slips in your all's pews. There's a little white church on the end when you all head out. If you'd rather put it in there, as well as we have our church center app, website, and then old snail mail. If we got our own P.O. box over here at the local post office. So let's go ahead and let's bow our heads and ask a blessing over this offering. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day that you've given us, Father. And Lord, I thank you for the blessing that we have a pastor that does stay and abide in your word, Father, and constantly turns to your word, Lord. I thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for the godly people that are in this church that keep everyone focused and stay in the word, Lord, and constantly pray without ceasing for others, Lord. Lord, I thank you for all these things. Lord, I ask that you let us give back the blessings that you've given us, Father, just a small portion, Lord. May it be your hands and feet. May it be used to your glory, Father, that we may be able to say it was you and not us at all, Lord. May it bring all the honor and glory to you. I ask all these things in your Son's blessed and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all so much for being here. Thank you for remembering us this month. It is the honor is truly ours. I know people say that, and I mean that as well. We're blessed to be here at Westside Baptist Church. And thank you for Brother Clay. I filled in the pulpit last week and just heard good things. And Clay, we're excited about how God's using you and you continuing to grow in your preaching and all that God's going to use you for throughout your life. And so I appreciate Clay filling in and others. Brother Ronnie, I think, filled in Sunday night as we honored Berea Baptist Pastor Kevin Slimp last week. And so that's why I was gone. They had asked me to share a few words, and it was a great time. So thank you for allowing us that time to be off. Well, today we continue in our series in Romans, The Road to Being Right with God. The Road to Being Right with God. We have worked our way up to Romans chapter 7. So if you'll turn to Romans chapter 7 and just hold on there a few minutes as we work through this chapter together. Now, I also want to say on our Sunday nights, we're calling it Reflections in Romans. We're meeting in the fellowship hall. And we put snacks and drinks out, and if you want to bring a snack to share, some have done that. You don't have to. We have some simple chips and cookies and things like that, or some people have brought fruit, and some people have brought some other goodies. But it's a very relaxed setting, and we discuss some as we reflect on the scripture that we looked at this morning. So that's what we'll be doing tonight. And I tell you, we have some really well-oiled Christians who bring out some great comments in those discussion times. I've really enjoyed that, and I know that you'll benefit from it, so come and be with us tonight at 6:30. Of course, we have our youth group meeting at 6:30, and of course, Jason, do we have Team Kid tonight for grades 1 through 5? You shall have no other gods before you. You shall not make any gods or idols. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet. Now, don't raise your hands, or unless you want to, but has anyone here kept all these perfectly? I haven't. Pam, did you raise your hand? Pam, get up here at this altar. Ha, ha, I've known you long enough. Well, I haven't. Let me ask you this. Do you feel that you've done pretty well on most of them? And don't answer that. But we're reminded, James chapter 2, verse 20 says, "For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it." In other words, if you've broken one, you're guilty of them all. And then in Matthew 5, on the Sermon on the Mount, what Jesus is teaching, he takes it to a whole new level. He said, and Jesus taught that even the inward desire to break the law in our hearts and our minds makes us just as guilty before God as if we committed the act outwardly. In other words, whether outwardly or inwardly, no one has kept the law perfectly other than one person, and that person is Jesus Christ. We all are guilty of failing to keep this holy and righteous law of God. But thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ, there is hope and there is help. In Romans chapter 6, we saw where the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and the presence of sin, the sin nature, has ended in the believer's life through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, and that the saved have been justified. And justification is a key theme of the book of Romans, and that means declared righteous by faith in Jesus Christ. And now Paul turns from sin in chapter 6 to the law, God's law, the Ten Commandments, or as they are literally the ten words of God, and how the law condemns us as sinners unreconciled to God. And in chapter 7 that we'll read this morning, the Apostle Paul declares that we who have been saved are also freed, listen, from the curse of the law that condemned us as lost and undone before God in heaven. That being said, let's read verse 1. Or do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person as long as he lives. You see, once, and we looked at this in chapter 6, and if you've forgotten that or haven't yet, go back and read that this week in your private devotion time. But once the old person has been put to death, we have been raised to walk in the newness of life, as the Scripture says, in the Spirit, and that happened through repentance, our turning away from sin and turning to Jesus Christ. And Christ, and through Christ, the curse of the law is removed. And the death of Jesus Christ on the cross made this possible for us to experience this freedom from the curse of the law. Because the law condemns us all as sinners, lost and undone. Now go to verse 2. For a married woman is bound by law to her husband while he lives, but if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law, and if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress. Now, here the Apostle Paul uses the illustration of marriage, and I want to you to keep in mind that he's using the illustration of marriage in a different time between the Hebrew people and those under the marriage laws of their ancient times. This is an illustration. It's not necessarily a teaching on marriage. And remember, in that day, in this context, women in this day and age were considered property of their husband when they were married to the husband. The main point to take away from this illustration is that the law is the husband to which the believer was one time married to. In other words, again, going by their laws, the law owned them. The law owned us when we were apart from Christ. But when the death of the old person has occurred through salvation, and that's what he speaks of in the marriage, there's a death. At that point, the marriage has been broken. When by faith that person became identified with the crucified Christ, Jesus. And so when this happens, the genuine Christian is now married to Jesus Christ by faith. Our Savior became our new husband, and we Christians, or the church, are now the bride of Christ, and we are no longer wed to or owned by the law. Now, let's be very clear this morning. This doesn't mean that we no longer have any obligation to obey God. To think such a thing or to live in such a way is an abomination. Our obligations are really even greater since we belong to God and the church, God's family. Now we serve Christ to bear spiritual fruit through obedience to the Holy Spirit. We walk by faith in the new way, living for Christ. It's the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. Go to verse 4 and we read verses 4 through 6. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. For while we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members. Now, when he says members, he's talking about his body and body parts. We're at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. Now, another thing, we are not to think or say that the law of God is bad, because without it, we would not have seen our sin. And without it, we would not have seen our sin and called out to Jesus Christ to be freed from its condemnation, as it has declared all of us as unfit and undone and separated from God. The law, the word, the 10 words reveals God's holiness, His character and righteousness. And it also reveals that there are none holy and righteous without the cleansing power of Jesus Christ in our lives. Let's be very clear here. There's nothing wrong with the law. It is perfect. There's nothing wrong with the law. The problem is with us and our inability to keep it perfectly. Go to verse 7 now as we read 7 through 13. What then shall we say? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. For I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. For apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law. But when the commandment came, sin came alive, and I died. The very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me, and through it killed me. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, and righteous and good. Did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond measure. So we still see here that there is still a problem between us and the law. We still have to deal with our fleshly or fallen nature. When we become saved, Christ has sealed the soul of the Christian with the Holy Spirit. He's washed us clean, forgiven us of our sins. Again, though, even though the Christian has been given a new nature with the Holy Spirit in our hearts, the flesh is still very much present and falls short of the glory of God. Now, in this chapter, and we're about to read those verses, we see that this truth greatly troubled Paul. And it also troubles each genuine Christian as well. We should never practice, listen, we should never practice and or celebrate the sin that Jesus bore on the cross. Hear those words. We should never practice or celebrate the sin that killed our Savior. And that's what we see in our nation, in our world today. People wanting to practice and celebrate, not just acknowledge, but celebrate the sin that killed our Savior, Jesus Christ. We also have not wanted to do the wrong thing in our life, but we didn't have the power to stop it. Paul is describing a point in his life, and we'll discuss this a little more tonight, or hear what you have to think about it. Paul is describing a point in his life, whether it was some, a time in the past, or whether it was in the present. He's describing a point in his life that we're about to read when he was a slave in bondage to sin, and he was wanting to be freed from its mastery. Go to verse 15. Excuse me. He says, "For I do not understand my own actions." Can you relate? "For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. And now if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. And now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. And so I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand." Never forget that. Even when we want to do right, evil lies close at hand. "For I delight in the law of God in my inner being." See, there's the Holy Spirit. That we delight in the law of God, that we want to do good, that we know we should, we have a desire to. "But I see in my members," here again he's talking about his body, "another law waging war against the law of my mind, and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members." And here, look at this. "Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" We all have had a desire to do the right thing, but we didn't have the power to complete what we wanted to do. We also have not wanted to do the wrong thing, but at times we didn't have the strength to keep from it. And this is our conflict with the two natures. One, the nature of the Holy Spirit that is within the believer, and also with the nature of the flesh which lies in us all. And I ask the question as Paul, who will deliver us from this body of death? Oh, but that's when first part of verse 25 comes up, and we get ready to get into chapter 8 next week, which is going to bless your heart. "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, who will deliver me from this body of death. I'm a wretched man. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord." Hear me today and believe this. There is no temptation and there is no sin that cannot be cleansed and overcome with Christ. Somebody say amen to that. Our failure to uphold the responsibilities of the Christian life should cause us to continually cast ourselves on Christ and to walk in the new way of the Holy Spirit. Our very inability to do right and not do wrong should make us more and more dependent upon Christ and not in our own flesh, less and less dependent upon our members, this body of death. Because the problem lies when we try to do good and not do bad in the strength of our flesh. And Paul's talking about that today. Without Christ, we are a wretched and a lost mess. We're a ball in tall weeds. Without His comfort, without His wisdom, and without His help, we are doomed for defeat. But with Him, we are given victory. And condemnation that comes from the law has been removed. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Now I ask a question this morning. Are you bound by the law, or do you walk in the new way of the Holy Spirit? Think about this. Do you say, you know what, I don't want to lie. I hate it that I lie sometimes, and I'm not going to lie in this situation. Or what about this? I'm not going to covet today, but I'm going to be happy with what I have. Is that the extent? Well, I want to tell you, the truth of the matter is, even people that are without Christ or don't know Christ or reject Christ say those things. They know that lying isn't good. They know that stealing is wrong. They know they should be more at peace with themselves. They know that jealousy is wrong. They know adultery is wrong. They know murder is wrong, unless something is wrong with them in other ways in their mind. So just to say that, just to say, well, I don't like it when I lie or steal or do anything like that, and I wish I could stop. Well, most of the world understands those things are wrong. And even some people are taking steps and trying to find help through other avenues to keep them from doing these things. So that doesn't mean you're walking in the Spirit just because you don't like that you've told a lie. Or do you say something like this? I know you're not going to say these exact words, but do you say something like this when you look at the law and you look at your sinful, this body of death? Lord, Lord Jesus, I want to please you today. And I want to walk in faith today. I want to live the life that you have for me to live. With Jesus as my Savior and Lord, I ask you, Holy Spirit, to use me today and produce through my life spiritual fruit and keep me on the path that you would have for me to walk. Now, again, you might not use those exact words, but it'd be something like that. You see, that's the difference of being still bound or wed to the law or being married to Jesus Christ. Are you fighting it in your own strength or looking for other avenues to keep you from doing wrong? Or are you trusting in Jesus Christ and wanting to serve Him? Looking unto Him for cleansing, for forgiveness, for justification, for wisdom, for power, for strength. You see, even people that don't know Jesus will say the one, but people that don't know Jesus won't say the latter that I just shared. That's the difference. And when you do that, the Holy Spirit, here's the great thing. When you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you're sealed with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is not going to lead you to lie, is He? The Holy Spirit is not going to lead you to steal. He's not going to lead you to cheat or to covet or kill. But the Holy Spirit, when you surrender your life to Him each new day, He's going to help you walk in the newness of life. And again, you see, one is bound to the law to walk in your own strength, which means you're going to fail. The other is looking to God for help, looking to God for strength and guidance, desiring by faith with Him as your one true God. Make no mistake, this morning the same God that gave us Jesus Christ as our Savior is the same God that gave us the law. The law shows our need for righteousness, and grace is the righteousness that we need to be saved through faith in Jesus Christ. Through His death and resurrection, God has provided the power to live and the freedom and the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's why Paul boldly proclaimed, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Look at verse 25 again. I didn't read all of it. And again, we're really getting ready to explore this even more next week in Romans chapter 8. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself serve the law of God with my mind. With my flesh, I serve the law of sin. The chapter ends with the realization of where we are in this life. In our fleshly and sinful nature, we're a slave to the law of sin. However, the genuine Christian that has repented, that has believed and committed themselves to serve the spiritual law of God, is freed. And they are now married to Christ, and the curse of the law has been broken. Remember, we started at where we started at the beginning, that we've all failed in that law, and with failing to meet those holy commandments, we are condemned as unclean and separated from God. But thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, we are saved, and the curse of the law has been removed. Thought of that old hymn this week. It's in our hymn book. Free from the law, O happy condition. Jesus hath bled, and there is remission. Cursed by the law and bruised by the fall, Christ hath redeemed us once for all. What are you to do this Lord's Day as we come to a close and prepare to sing a hymn of invitation? Here's what you do, what Paul did. He realized his weakness. He cast himself upon Christ, and that is what we are to do today. Come to him just as we are and cast yourself upon Jesus Christ. Cast yourself upon Jesus Christ for freedom, for forgiveness, for deliverance, and for victory. And beloved, each and every one of us should submit ourselves to Christ, serving him with the Holy Spirit's help. Help us, O God, today, and remove the curse that is upon us. Save someone today, Lord Jesus, with the Holy Spirit's influence. Come just as you are. The altar is open. You can come and pray alone with the Lord or with a friend. I will also be down front for any who might, for the very first time in your life, be coming to Jesus Christ publicly and openly. Maybe rededicating your life or following through with scriptural biblical baptism, whatever it might be. You come and cast yourself on Christ just as you are. Let's stand together and sing.
Oh,
with